If we don't have new, innovative, amazing ideas and ways to tell a story and create experiences, then we can shut this down and go home.
I am so excited to introduce Maverick Carter.
Thank you.
Maverick grew up in Akron, Ohio, and played high school basketball with LeBron James. And when LeBron started building a business early in his NBA career, he could have called an NBA agent. He could have called a powerful Hollywood agent. He didn't. He called his high school childhood best friend, Maverick. And so it's been many years of them together building this company, the SpringHill Company. Maverick's the co-founder and CEO. So we have a lot to talk about. But first, let's welcome Maverick to the stage.
Thank you.
So let's go back to the beginning. You started your career as a field representative at Nike. Tell us about leaving Nike, moving back to Akron, Ohio, and choosing to work with LeBron.
I actually started as an intern at Nike a long time ago now. And then I was a consultant and they hired me and I moved to Beaverton where Nike is headquartered and worked there for 3 years or so. And then decided to leave based on a decision that I had made in a conversation with LeBron where he wanted to make changes about his career. I knew that there was opportunity and I knew if we thought about it the right way, we could build something pretty amazing. The idea was just, if you really believed, like we did, in the longevity of LeBron's playing career. So if you believed in that, then how would we also match and build something in parallel off the court that was a business that really paralleled that and knew it would take a lot of twists and turns and thinking, but ended up building a content company, the SpringHill Company, which really makes sense based on my background and who he is. And it's paralleled his career. Now hopefully we have a company that'll last much longer than his career.
So you've been described as the creative director of all things LeBron. Tell us, you know, what that means. What are the most critical elements of, you know, building a brand around LeBron James?
If you are good at storytelling, then you can actually build something that matters and talk to your audience in a way that really matters. And then you start to build business. Well, then that's kind of what we were thinking back then with what we were going to do. And then the idea is also when you're talking about a person in LeBron, it was never, we never sat around and go like, what's the LeBron brand? A brand, if it works, will never change, right? People know it, they like it. So a person to me can never be a brand because you're always changing, evolving. So it was more about how do we build businesses and other brands that we can actually have a real effect on through our way of storytelling and with LeBron's name, likeness, and image to really help supercharge and really own a piece of the equity and capture enterprise value instead of just taking fees and helping someone else build enterprise value.
So let's shift to the SpringHill Company. You created Uninterrupted, which is this basic belief that athletes should have the ability to share their own stories uninterrupted. And so how did that idea come about and how has it evolved since then?
The way that came about was the first time LeBron decided to switch teams, going to a really good franchise in Miami that had great leadership. We produced a show called The Decision, which was now forever ago, but widely seen as a terrible mistake and a disaster, and forced me to hide out in my grandmother's basement for a couple months. And it was not well produced as a TV show, but the idea and the ambition was there. The ambition was there and the idea was right. It just was not executed greatly. But then when LeBron, being who he is, decided to leave Miami and go back to Cleveland, we did the same thing, but this time he wrote it in as a letter. And there was a line in the letter that said, I'm doing it this way instead of like a press conference so I can get out all of my thoughts and ideas uninterrupted. Like entrepreneurs, you see an opportunity, you see a need in this instance. We saw a need from consumers wanting to hear directly from athletes and hear stories, and athletes that wanted to tell stories. So we built the company and the platform and the brand. And today it's grown, you know, there's a couple hundred people who work there. And the beauty of it is, then nobody was doing it. Everyone is doing it now. That's awesome. We applaud everyone out there attempting to do it.
So maybe let's spend some time on the SpringHill mission more broadly, which is, you know, to empower greatness in every individual from creator to consumer. How do you think about the culture of the company? How do you think about the projects that you pursue or don't pursue?
The key word in there is empowering or empowerment. And that starts with all the people who work at our company, first and foremost. We want to empower employees with, because we're an idea company. We're a creative company. Creativity is at the center of what we do. I tell the team and the company all the time, if we don't have new, innovative, amazing ideas and ways to tell a story and create experiences, then we can shut this down and go home. We have to put ideas at the center of what we do, but also that becomes a thread that we pull through everything we do, because on one end of our company, our studio team is making film, TV, storytelling projects. And on another end, we're creating products, building commerce and products, doing licensing deal, licensing out our IP. And those are two totally different types of people. But that thread, we have to pull that thread there, and that thread is what holds it, that thread of empowerment is what holds it all together. And it starts with the people who work at our company.
You guys also do a lot of branded content for partners, Walmart, Nike, Uber, Procter & Gamble, many, many others. How does your mission translate into your partnerships with those companies and sort of your client relationships?
Yeah, our mission translates directly into those partnerships, because when we work with brands like a Nike, it is them understanding our mission. So when we work with brands like you said, LVMH and Google, Nike, and we work with a Procter & Gamble, we're not an agency for hire, meaning we don't just give you our ideas and you go make commercials and put your brand. It's us partnering and co-producing content with them. And as all these big brands start slowly transition from transactions with customers and consumers to engaging members, then they need content. So we bring our mission to the table, and they want that, because athletes don't want to just be in commercials anymore. They want to create content. So help us do that together.
So The Shop Uninterrupted was on HBO for 4 seasons. I think earlier this year you renewed for a 5th season, but it's on Uninterrupted's YouTube channel. So talk about how you choose different channels, platforms for content distribution. How do you think about that?
Yeah, I think using that example, which is a good one, the show was on HBO for 4 seasons, and HBO was a fantastic partner, really helped us launch the show. But we own the IP, The Shop, and we own the episodes, but we would license them to HBO and they come back after a certain amount of years. But then as The Shop has grown, we really saw The Shop as a franchise in the similar way that Disney would look at Toy Story or Disney would look at Star Wars. And when we were raising capital, we closed around last October. One of the things I talked about, like the headline, you know, like when you walk in, you guys have all, as entrepreneurs, walked into those investor meetings, you wanna like leave something that like they can, you know, there's always all type of questions. But I was like, what am I leaving them with that like sticks to their head? And mine was like, we wanna build Disney for culture. And one day I was sitting around at home, I was like, I really said that in the meeting? Like, that's really arrogant. And it's also really ambitious too, but that was my thing to leave them with. So then how does that come in practice? Well, with The Shop, HBO was a great partner, but it was time for us. The Shop, it became more than a show. It was now a franchise, what we call a franchise, an IP. So now we have to think about the best way to grow it, leverage it, monetize it, but also monetize it so it lasts forever. Now on YouTube, we have a couple of things. It becomes international with a click of a button. Now we have no restrictions on time. Now we can make it 45 minutes, 20 minutes. And you know, we've had everyone from Obama to Jay-Z to Tom Brady, Drew Barrymore, it just on the show. And we tape sometimes 2 hours, sometimes 2.5. So now we have that freedom. Thirdly, now my brand partnerships team can bring in a brand partners. And then lastly, we can promote our own products that we sell. We're gonna now do a brick and mortar space with the shop. So it really starts to look like a real franchise, and putting it on YouTube, that specific piece of IP and franchise really works for us. And again, just keeping that thread through all of it, which the shop is about community empowerment.
So you and LeBron are co-founders in all of this. How do you guys split roles and responsibilities at the SpringHill Company? How do you guys think about that?
Well, he scores 30 points a night. I don't get involved in that. But at the company, he is the chairman of the company. He's the chairman of our board. He spends a lot of time on how are we growing franchises like the shop. We have a brand called Love Is with Megan Rapinoe and Sue Bird. How are we growing that? We have a piece of IP called Throwing Bones. How are we growing that? He's very focused on like the growth of that. How are we protecting those brands? And then how can he help? Because he's obviously a gigantic promotional engine and engine himself. So he really focuses on that. The day-to-day stuff, he assumes I'm taking care of it.
So let's shift to your social endeavors. You talked about this philosophy of more than, and maybe explain to the group what that means and how it influences where you spend your time across social endeavors beyond the business.
Yeah, I mean, the business is obviously a for-profit company, but it's a bit of a social endeavor also, because our company today is about 220 people. At the SpringHill Company, we're actually exactly 50-50 male-female, and we're 67% people of color. So the idea of being more than is embedded in our company is one of the reasons we founded the company, because as we talked earlier, LeBron gave me an opportunity and empowered me to be more than what the world would ever see me as, right? As a back then 22-year-old black kid from the inner city in Akron. And I still wake up every day wanting to prove that I am more than what the world would perceive me as or say I am every day. So that's what the company, that's one of the ethos that we're founded in. Uninterrupted, our sports brand, that was the tagline, more than an athlete, but also things I do outside the company, whether it's helping people. We obviously, LeBron has a gigantic foundation where he's basically trying to rebuild the whole inner city of Akron. So that feeling of being more than, proving that you're more than, is embedded in everything that we do.
So I want to get to your grandmother's basement. Some people are more willing and able to take risk. You talked about your grandmother a lot. Explain your approach to taking risk, how she influenced you, and how that might have changed over time.
My grandmother is who gave me my name, Maverick. When my mom went into labor, my grandmother was at a poker game. So she was playing poker and she left the poker game to come to the hospital to name me. And the reason she was at a poker game is because she ran the poker game. My grandmother's basement was what we call an after hours. And I met all type of people there. There's everybody from the community was there. And as a kid, I would sweep up when the game was over, but she cooked food, gave the food away for free. And I asked her one time, why do you give the food away for free? If you weren't playing, you had to pay for a plate, like $5. If you were playing, you ate for free. And she says, because the rule, and this is another entrepreneurial thing, you got to keep the players playing. And you don't want them to have to get up and leave. And she gave me my name because of the TV show. She loved gambling and the TV show from the 60s. Where their last name was Maverick. But she taught me how to gamble as a kid, like literally taught me how to play poker. The earliest memory I have learning was in her bedroom, like 5 years old, 6 years old. And what it taught me was that to process the information that you have and quickly get to an answer of what's my upside and what's my floor, and then make a decision. And I do that every day in business, because in cards, the lovely thing about cards, and she always had this line, and we'd like be playing cards, and I'd say to her, like, the hand would be over and she'd win, and I'd say, let me see the next card, and you see it, and it's like, you turn it over, and it's a six, a club, and you're like, I should have stayed. I could have used that six, a club. And she would say, son, that's why the cards have backs on them. And what it taught me was that with every, if you're playing any type of card game, with every turn of the card, you get more information. And every time there's a card turn, you're getting fresh information. So therefore, your upside and downside are changing with every turn of the card. And you have to make a decision whether to stay in or get out. And that's basically life.
I want to end with wishing you a happy birthday.
Thank you.
Thank you, Maverick.